The docks and the trains had their heyday before the Second World War. Historically, the railway's existence depended on business booming in the docks. Now it's the other way round. Back in 1840, it was the London and Blackwall Railway, which was later extended to the Isle of Dogs. In those early days, steam trains were considered a fire risk, so the first trains were pulled round Docklands by rope or by horses. As the docks declined, so the railway declined with them and died by the 60s. It was two decades later that the London Dockland Development Corporation was set up to breathe new life into the area. Top priority, a transport system to attract industry and homes. Extending the existing rail service and the Jubilee line would have cost £325 million. The government balked at the price. So, light rail technology using existing tracks and lightweight trains was the answer. And the price was right, £77 million. The government agreed, and the necessary Acts of Parliament were passed. Politicians from both sides quickly jumped on board. In 84, the GLC's transport chairman Dave Wetzel got to work on clearing the site. Environment Secretary Patrick Jenkin launched the building work, or tried to. By the middle of the following year, the entire path of the railway was completed, including the toughest section, a new bridge a quarter of a mile long. The first sign of trouble came in March, when a train overshot the rails during unscheduled tests. Human error was blamed. Now, the engineers and technicians are trying to sort out the latest problems which have stopped the public using the trains. Once that's done, and the railway's proved itself, they'll move on to the next stage, the extension to Bank, to Beckton and the Docklands Airport, and possibly south of the river into Greenwich and Lewisham. That depends to a large extent on the results of the tests, and the biggest test of all begins once it's in service, when the fare-paying public will decide its future.